Genevieve Esguerra, and I'm part of the romance class community of authors and readers, the people who put this event together. We had help from the great people at Glorietta 5, Ayala Malls, and Little Free Library. All day, we'll be taking book donations. Bring any kind of book, we'll accept them. All of them will go to the Little Free Library installations in the different Ayala Malls. There's one here at the concierge desk. So check it out. It's gonna look like that. Romance class is a community of authors and readers of romance in English. Most of the books sold here are romance in English and indie, independently published. Some of us are both indie and published by a publisher. And the response of readers like you who come to events like this can help turn a rare, hard-to-find indie book into a bookstore bestseller. If you need help buying anything, ask the volunteers, ask anyone in this kind of shirt, and they can probably give you recommendations and favorites. Tell them if you're into nice, naughty, sweet, steamy, spicy, whatever. So this is like dating. They'll want to find a book that's a match for you. Everything you see here, from the books and their covers, the shirts, the stickers, the tote bags, the little signs, the little mugs, that's been created by someone in the community. If this is something you want to be part of, we're on Facebook under Groups Romance Class PH. So, to start our program, I love everyone here, but the highlight of every event is when we have the live readings. When our favorite people. So here today to read excerpts from romance class novels are Gio Gahol, Rachel Coates, Gab Pangilinan, and Herb Alvarez. Sweeter by the Second, from Maybe This Time.
I see Ethan.
If George noticed that I changed the topic, he didn't call me out on it. He chatted a few more minutes before I logged off with a promise that I would see him soon. He'd be in Manila for a couple of months anyway. Closing my laptop, I went and searched for Tony. I found him in the sala, leaning on the barandilla by the window. The glare of the sun contrasted with the dimness of the room, throwing his profile into relief. He looked pensive and serious. Very different from his carefree expression last night when he celebrated my liberation from the bedroom. Manang Dalma had finally declared me well enough to eat in the dining room that night. She ordered Tony and me to relax in the sala as she finished preparing dinner. I sat on a solihia chaise and gazed out the window. Dusk in Jimenez was magical. The sky was full of lovely colors. The ringing of the church bells blended with the chirping of the crickets. And a gentle breeze wafted in through the open windows. Tony was taking another swig of his beer when I noticed the bare spot on his left hand. You aren't wearing your ring. He shrugged.
It was making you uncomfortable.
You didn't have to, I reproached him.
I wanted to. It's been years since Sheila passed on, and you're here again.
Gingerly, he took my hand in his.
It's a sign, right?
Wasn't? I don't know if I believe in science anymore. He squeezed my hand hard.
I do. I believe in it for both of us.
I didn't know what to make of that.
Rin?
I blinked. Tony's voice recalled me back to the present. He was smiling now, his stance relaxed. You wanted me?
I've always wanted to.
Tony replied. Hannah Dalmo, who had just come in with a vase of flowers, actually giggled before she hurried back out. Tony, I could feel my cheeks heating in embarrassment. That wretch actually laughed.
Don't tell me you got him shy.
He teased. I rolled my eyes. Tony wooed the same way he did everything else, with single-minded determination. It had been like that when we first got it together. I used to tease him that I said yes just because he was so makulit. He'd used the same strategy last week. He dropped in on my lectures, brought me drinks and snacks, bribed little kids to hand me notes and flowers, and stood solicitously by my side as we toured the town. On top of that, there had been the smiles, the heated looks, and the accidental touches that all sent my blood racing. And I wasn't assuming anything here. The whole town was excitedly buzzing with the news. My nililigaw ang si May, si Vice.
I have to attend the birthday fiesta tonight. Would you like to come along?
Yes. After being cooped up for days, the idea of going someplace excited me no end. Tony laughed.
I never thought you'd be this enthusiastic about a simple fiesta.
I'm not the same girl I once was.
Good.
He smiled and took my hand.
I'm not the boy I used to be either.
I hate you. Tony chuckled as he grabbed the last torta.
Why?
You made me sing. I made a grab for the torta but missed. Tony and I had just gotten back from the fiesta. We were in the dining room having a midnight snack.
I suggested one song. You're the one who did the mini concert.
I groaned and buried my face in my hands.
Even make up in the pillow,
right? He snickered. Those were tears of joy. I punched him on the shoulder. His wife requested that song specifically for him. The fiesta had been a simple affair. There had been songs and dances, speeches from Tony and other local officials, parlor games and disco dancing in the basketball court. The food had been simple but yummy. I'd eaten so much torta, a sponge cake sprinkled with sugar, they'd sent a box home with me. Smiling, I scrolled through my phone and played a video of Tony dancing with a school principal. At least I now have blackmail material. This looks really painful. Tony groaned. He'd never been much of a dancer. He ate the last bite of torta and smiled at me.
I missed you.
I missed you too. I didn't even know how much until I saw him again.
Really? Are you seeing anyone?
Ashra, I see a lot of people. But at his pointed look, I shook my head. No. I haven't been serious about anyone for a while now.
Not even that guy you were chatting with earlier today?
You mean George? Tony frowned.
You guys aren't together?
I laughed. No, why are you so interested in George?
I saw you years ago.
Huh? Where? Tony sighed and turned away.
In New York. I went to see you, you know.
You did? My heart soared. I thought he'd forgotten all about me. Nodding, Tony continued.
I was accepted for a 2-week internship at Roth & Baker and I wanted to surprise you.
Pausing, he turned to look at me.
It turns out I was the one who got surprised. I saw you with a guy, George, and he had his arm around you and you looked so intimate. I realized you moved on, so I left.
Tony, George and I were never together.
You weren't?
I nodded. George is touchy-feely as hell, but I wouldn't want to cross his boyfriend. Adrian's crazy. Scary.
So George is gay?
Instead of answering, I asked him, Tony, why'd you go to see me? Pulling me onto his lap, he buried his face in my hair.
Because I needed to. and I needed that we were apart.
His embrace was meant to be comforting, but my traitorous body had other ideas. Leaning into him, I breathed in the scent that was uniquely his. I wasn't happy either, but I had to go. His arms tightened around me as he nuzzled my neck.
I understand. You had to follow your dream, and it was selfish of me to want to keep you by my side.
Tony stopped what he was doing to look into my eyes. But I have had enough. Cupping his face, I pulled him in for a kiss. Tugging at his shirt, I murmured, "Can we talk later?" Tony laughed and helped me undo the buttons. He kissed my jawline while I drew his cup from his shoulders. As he shrugged it off completely, I got my first look at his new physique. I blinked. Twice. Jesus, Tony, what happened to you? Holy kamote, he had abs now. He had abs now. I simply couldn't form any intelligent reply. But I'm sure that by the way I kept running my hands over his torso, he knew that I totally approved. My shirt and bra were whisked away, and I know when our very skin is touched.
Win.
Hmm?
We're making it work this time.
It was the last coherent thing I remembered either of us saying.
Save the cake, cried fellow Torres. We used the bypass that ran through the southern part of Manila to reach the bacon supply store, but we were still stuck in heavy traffic with Junju.
These are damn good buys,
Sean said, between bites of his Mexican beef empanada.
We put in them anyway.
It's a secret. There's no way you can drag that out of me.
Okay then.
He finished off the last of his empanada.
So, wait. Tell me more about Hazel and Freddy getting together.
Oh, you mean their first date at McDonald's?
I was eating my empanada when you were telling the story.
And I just had to watch him eat that same empanada. Okay, so we were here, Denise and I, at the old McDonald's in Greenbelt, watching Hazel and Vinny go on their first date because Ms. Valencia did not trust Hazel to go alone. And Vinny, he brought along two of his cousins with him, and they were the most boring people ever because all they could ever talk about were their cars and their branded clothes.
Branded? Like, house?
I nearly choked on my tuna and banana. Okay, check this out. One of the guys was named Armand, and he comes up to me and says, "Hello, I'm Armand, like Armand." And then he points to his shirt, his jeans, and he goes, "Armani, Armani, Armand." He laughed so hard he knocked off his camera. Are you gonna edit that?
I'll cut it out. I'll edit about Vinny's boring cousins, I promise.
He opened the box and took out a brownie.
I wouldn't want to see you get embarrassed.
Oh, you're a real sweetheart, Sean.
Thanks.
Then,
I heard you didn't have a boyfriend until you turned 21.
So, you did talk to Hazel after all, the cad.
It's not that embarrassing.
He said,
Hazel just thought it was weird how you never expressed any interest in guys during high school.
Well, Woodrow's isn't exactly an awe-inspiring place to find a boyfriend, to be honest.
Hazel also gave me the impression that you were very serious with your studies.
I had to, Sean. I was on partial scholarship, remember?
I can only imagine.
Yeah. The only parties I was invited to were the ones where Mrs. Valencia asked me to chaperone because she thought I was a good influence on Hazel. If only your aunt knew what we were up to behind her back.
Deeper Rosemary can be very dense when it comes to those things.
I fought the urge to hand him another brownie so he could lick it off my fingers.
So, wait, you were at McDonald's with Vinny's cousins, and all you did was watch those two split a super-sized order of french fries?
Yes. Back then, I thought it was the sweetest thing ever, but now that I think about it, it was cheesy.
There's nothing cheesy about splitting a box of fries on the first date.
Not if I split those fries with this guy. Dave got some nice shots of those two eating some cake. Can you get those?
Yeah. I need an insulin shot after that.
Talk have a sense of humor. I think they're in it for the long haul, Sean. And you can quote me on that.
No, it didn't.
I watched his hands adjust the angles of the camera. And I wondered how they would feel if I kissed them. Sean?
Yes?
I looked away. And I wished I could take back the last few seconds I'd spent staring at his hands. We're getting close to the supply store. Are you ready? One smile from him was all it took to answer my question. We arrived at the baking supply store at 11 o'clock. Don't take any pictures, I said. Leave the camera in your bag.
Fine by me.
We walked past the unmarked packages of glycerine and gold dust, and Sean asked questions about the supplies that were available at the store. This place sells the specific brand of ice and sugar we've been using in all our baked goods since the 70s, I said, pointing to the large cartons on the shelf. The smaller boxes are available at the supermarket, but we'd rather buy them wholesale because that's how much ice and sugar we use for everything.
So what happens when you don't use this kind of icing sugar?
People can't tell the difference. There was this one time after Lola died when Papa used another brand of icing sugar and business slowed down because the customers from the village would complain it didn't taste the same. The icing for our cakes don't hold up as well as the other sugar, with the other sugars it did with this one.
Wow. You really do know your sugar.
Oh, there's more. I steered him to a section devoted to chocolate. Medallions were melting and molding, boxes of cocoa, chocolate chips in every form. As you can see, bakers use a lot of chocolate in their work.
This place is like a dream,
he said.
No wonder you have to go out of your way to get here.
For a moment, I wondered if I'd overwhelmed him with all of this information about the cake business, like a tourist at a temple. Instead, we kept walking through the aisles, taking in the sights side by side. As the traffic slowed to a near crawl on the way back home, I went back telling stories about Hazel and Vinny. Did I tell you about how Vinny was Hazel's first in everything? He clapped his hands over his
ears. I'm not listening.
Since when did you become such a prude?
I'm her cousin, okay? The last thing I want to know about Hazel and Vinny is the quality of their sex.
Okay, so then you won't let me tell you about the times we read all the sex articles from Cosmo Aloud when we were in high school? He reached for his bottle of water.
You must have been horrified.
Like I said, I wasn't into boys in high school. My mom was worried that I was never going to get a boyfriend.
And how many boyfriends have you had since then?
Now he wanted to get into my sex life too. Fantastic. Well, the last one was 4 years ago. It was ugly.
I bet he was ugly too.
I couldn't believe he just went there. Wait, why are you talking about me again?
Because
what? He put away his water, took down the tripod, and reached across the seat. Then his fingers threaded through my hair, and we kissed for the first time.